This is, well, first let me say, it's my great pleasure to be back here in Bogota, Colombia, and I hope the weather is nicer tomorrow, because tomorrow I will be, the other side of my existence is taking photographs. I travel a lot, so I have an opportunity of doing this. This is a kind of an interesting talk which developed as sort of a hobby of mine, because I thought about the discoveries that I've made in my career as a scientist, and then I sort of started thinking about other people's discoveries. And so this is really about how advances in science are made, and I suppose that starts with discoveries. Obviously, there's a lot of work that's involved in the advancement of science. I guess there are a number of messages I want to give you. This is the first. I should tell you that all of these images that you see, the backgrounds, are all photographs that I've taken. So you get some feeling for how passionate a photographer I am. So the first of these messages is that those discoveries that most change the way we think about nature cannot be anticipated. How then are such discoveries made, and are there research strategies that can substantially increase one's chances of making such a discovery? So obviously the answer to that has to be yes, or I wouldn't have asked the question. But let me illustrate this with a linked chain of discoveries and inventions, starting with one of my great heroes, this person here. And I don't know how many of you recognize this, but this is Heikki Kamerlionis, who was the first person to liquefy helium, which of course is the substance that led to my Nobel Prize. But at the turn of the last century, the late 1800s, Kamerlionis was in a competition with Dewar to see who could first liquefy the lightest and most inert of the atmospheric gases. And it looked like Dewar had won when Dewar liquefied hydrogen. I dare say that hydrogen is not a very inert gas, but that didn't matter. And so eventually, people had already seen evidence for the existence of helium coming from spectral lines from the sun, and ultimately Kamerlionis was able to get enough helium to fill a small party balloon, I suppose. It was very rare at that time. And then he developed a set of refrigeration processes that allowed him to liquefy helium. Of course, it liquefies at atmospheric pressure at 4.2 Kelvin. But that was certainly the lowest temperature that had ever been reached on Earth at that time. And then he did with helium exactly what Dewar had done with hydrogen. Dewar had pumped on the vapor above liquid hydrogen, causing it to cool further and allowing him to find the temperature at which hydrogen solidified under its own vapor pressure. Well, so Kamerlionis tried to do this with helium, and he pumped and he pumped, ultimately reaching a temperature of roughly 2 degrees above absolute zero, but in fact, the helium never solidified. I personally have cooled helium-3 down to a temperature of 1/10,000th of a Kelvin, and it stays very happily in a fluid state. The reasons for this, of course, had to do with quantum mechanics, which was just being developed at this period of time. So this is Heikki Kamerlionis, who received the Nobel Prize in 1913 for having liquefied helium. Now, after failing to be able to solidify helium by cooling it further, he sort of thought about what interesting questions of the day he could answer using this refrigeration process that he developed, which was actually quite complicated. And people were debating what would happen to the conductivity of a very pure metal if you could cool it all the way to absolute zero. One school of thought was that as you cooled it, you eliminated the lattice vibrations which scattered the conduction electrons. And so the expectation was that as you cooled, gradually the electrical resistance would drop towards zero. But the other school of thought suggested that at some temperature, the conduction electrons, which were free to roam around the interior of the metal, would recondense on the ions from which they'd come, and all the electrical conductivity would cease. So Camaleonis was able to get hold of a sample, a very pure sample of mercury, which is a metal which is relatively easy to purify, and he directed his associate, I don't know if it was a graduate student or not, Gilles Holst, to measure the electrical resistance of the sample of mercury as he cooled it down to the lowest temperatures they would reach. So you can see here the temperature goes from 4 Kelvin to 4.5 Kelvin, and the electrical resistance from 0 to 2/1000ths of an ohm. And here are his data, these green points. I dare say that the original article, of course, since this is around 1900, was not published in color. These were added by me. But anyway, so the electrical resistance is dropping very gradually. But then all of a sudden, at a temperature of about 4.2 Kelvin, there was essentially a discontinuous drop in the electrical resistance to a value that was less than 10 to the minus 5 ohms, which was the resolution of their equipment. So supposedly, when Gilles Holst showed this to Camaleonis, Camaleonis was absolutely confident that a lead had fallen off of the sample. It was a four-wire measurement, but in fact, these results were reproducible. And this, of course, we understand this, was the first observation of superconductivity, something that has been studied in multiple places around the world ever since that time, and is still, in fact, a very, if I can use this word, hot topic of research for condensed matter physicists. So let's look at the relevant research strategies that allowed this discovery of superconductivity to be made. First, use the best instrumentation available, and Camaleonis had developed a remarkable refrigeration device which allowed him to reach temperatures below those that any other human had ever reached. Don't reinvent, borrow the technologies you can, and by this I want to point out that Dewar had invented the Dewar flask in order to help him solidify hydrogen, and even though these two were very bitter rivals, Camaleonis was very happy to borrow this technology in his efforts to solidify helium, which of course he didn't do. Look into an unexplored region of the physical landscape. Now, for various reasons, I suppose curiosity, wishing to answer this question about what would happen to the conductivity, Camaleonis was the first person to actually measure the property of anything as a function of temperature at these very low temperatures. And then I should say failure might be an invitation to try something new. So it was only after failing to solidify helium that he was able to do something really very different and discover superconductivity. Now, although he did discover a superconductivity and he liquefied helium, in fact, he failed to understand that at very low temperatures, the helium-4 that was his liquid cryogen actually became a superfluid. He wrote in his lab book at some point that at roughly 2 Kelvin, it appears that the liquid helium stops boiling when I pump away the vapor on top. So be aware of subtle unexplained behavior. Don't dismiss it. I never know which button to push. Okay, so I don't know that anyone actually got the Nobel Prize specifically for the discovery of superfluidity in helium-4. Over the years, people had begun to realize that liquid helium at very low temperatures had kind of unusual properties. The person, I suppose, that came closest to having discovered superfluidity was this person here, Peter Kapitsa, who I actually knew. He's dead now, but in 1937, Kapitsa measured the viscosity of liquid helium-4 and found its viscosity below about 2.17 Kelvin was vanishingly small, less than, I think, a few billionths of a poise. And this work was done in 37. It wasn't until 1978 that he was recognized for his work on helium-4. And for that, he shared the Nobel Prize in 1978, 41 years after his groundbreaking studies. So I dare say some people have to wait longer for their Nobel Prizes than other people. It's best not to wait, I suppose, just keep doing things. Anyway, he shared the Nobel Prize, however, with two colleagues whose work had nothing to do with his own. These were people that I knew, however. Arno Penzias, when I was department head at AT&T Bell Laboratories, Arno Penzias was my boss's boss's boss. So you can see how far up I got on the management chain. I was the department head. Anyway, Penzias and Wilson were a completely different scale of research. Very interested in making very sensitive measurements of electromagnetic radiation coming in from outer space. And specifically, they were able to use a very sensitive microwave receiver that AT&T had developed in early experiments on telecommunications via satellite. So I don't know if any of you remember those days, but because the satellite was in a geosynchronous orbit quite high, there was a long delay between when you said something and when the other person heard it. It was very complicated. It didn't really work. On the other hand, this piece of apparatus that AT&T put together ended up being very important for these two gentlemen. So this is a picture of the microwave receiver that Penzias and Wilson were using. And of course, it looks like a piece of junk to most of us today, but this was, at this time, the world's most sensitive microwave receiver. The fact that it has a horn-shaped antenna meant that it wouldn't couple to electromagnetic radiation coming from the ground that might be coming from terrestrial sources. But inside this little shed here, there was the most sensitive and quietest amplifier that had ever been made, thanks to some other gentlemen I'll talk about in a minute. But when they first trained this on the sky, oops. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. So I have to identify John Bardeen. John Bardeen is someone who kind of sort of I'm sorry, Charles Townes. I always get these guys confused. Charles Townes is actually still alive, but he's 97 right now, and he still is very active. Kind of an amazing guy. He's gone into astrophysics, but in fact, this is Charles Townes, who of course invented the maser. Now this is the ammonia maser specifically, although it was quite impressive what they did with it, this was not a technology which was useful for Penzias and Wilson. However, the maser itself, the idea that one could do this, then allowed Nicholas Bloembergen at Harvard to build the maser parametric amplifier using a doped ruby rod, which could then be cooled to low temperatures, say to 4.2 Kelvin, and that, in fact, provided the most sensitive microwave receiver. So Penzias and Wilson eventually took this over this device. They actually added a microwave switch so they could switch the input source to this preamplifier from whatever electromagnetic radiation was coming in on the horn antenna to electromagnetic radiation being radiated by a black body at a temperature of 4.2 Kelvin. It's liquid helium temperature. So here, their data, this always would come out on a strip chart recorder. The paper would move slowly downward as a pen scribe the response of the amplifier. So this is looking at the noise coming in from the antenna, and then they switched to looking at the noise coming in from a black body at a temperature of 4.2 Kelvin. The bottom line was, when they got all done with these measurements, they concluded that there was excess noise that they didn't understand at the level of about 3.3 Kelvin. And they tried very hard to make that go away. So they went back and looked at their antenna, and they climbed up inside the antenna. What they found was that the pigeons had been roosting inside the antenna. And so they knocked down the pigeon nests and mopped up the pigeon droppings, and I think there were a few corroded copper plates. But absolutely nothing that they could do would make that excess noise go away. And of course, we know now that this is the 3-degree blackbody radiation being radiated, basically filling all of space, but in fact it originated from the period not very long after the Big Bang, when protons and electrons combined together to form neutral hydrogen. At that point, the electromagnetic radiation decoupled from the matter. So let's look at the relevant research strategies that allowed this discovery to be made. First, and again, use the best technology available. In this case, they didn't design it or build it. They only added that one switch. It was really AT&T, the parent organization, that was responsible for that. Don't reinvent the wheel, borrow if possible. Now, you know, it's frequently you will always feel that you want to make your own technology. But in this case, this microwave receiver was in fact the best in the world, and there was really no need to borrow anything. Look into a region of parameter space that is unexplored, and of course they were the first people to look at to see this cosmic microwave background radiation. But they weren't the first person to actually have thought about looking for it. There was a fellow named Robert Dickey who had read a paper that suggested that there might be fossil radiation left over from the Big Bang. And so Dickey was at Princeton University, and he was also looking for this cosmic microwave background radiation. But he was using a conventional tube preamplifier, and which had a characteristic noise temperature, that is the amount of noise that it introduced into the system, of 2,000 Kelvin, whereas Penzias and Wilson's had a characteristic noise temperature of just a couple of Kelvin. So again, it really helps to use the best instrumentation you can, and really be sure that you understand what your instrumentation is measuring. If you don't, and you see something that you don't understand, you're very likely to say, well, this is due to some artifact introduced by my instrumentation. And so it's really important to understand what you're using. Well, let me say that other people then started looking at this cosmic microwave background radiation, and I think John Mather and George Smoot were given the Nobel Prize in 2006 for having not discovered the cosmic microwave background radiation, but discovering very important properties about that radiation. So here, in fact, is a measurement of the intensity of that radiation as a function of wavelength, and it has a very characteristic curve, which is characteristic of a black body radiating at a temperature of 2.725 Kelvin with an accuracy and resolution of about 1/1000th of a degree. Now, this was already very exciting because by this time people realized that this, in fact, was radiation that had been created in the early universe and had decoupled from the matter about 400,000 years after the Big Bang. And then as the universe expanded, that radiation cooled, and that's why it was at this temperature of 2.725 Kelvin. However, they also found that the temperature of that radiation was not uniform. Well, at first they saw that it was warmer in the direction that the Earth was going, and cooler in the opposite direction. And this is simply Doppler shift of the optical frequency or microwave frequency. So it was easy to get rid of that. And then what they saw was, in fact, a funny splotchiness, but this was the plane of the Milky Way galaxy. And after they were able to get rid of this signal, in fact, none of this other stuff went away. And it became clear in not very long that this fluctuation, which was highly reproducible in time, was a result of fluctuations in the density of the universe 400,000 years after the Big Bang, at the point where matter and radiation decoupled from one another. So if one satellite is good, two are better. And so this is a satellite called WMAP. Now, this did essentially the same thing, but with much higher resolution than what had been done earlier. The W, I should tell you, is for David Wilkinson. David Wilkinson was a colleague of Robert Dickey in the early experiment that they did, of course, which didn't find anything. And he was, in fact, I think, one of the strong proponents of this satellite, this very complicated and sophisticated satellite. However, he died before the satellite got up into orbit. So if you wish to do an experiment with NASA, first go see your doctor and find out if you're healthy enough. Okay, I see that, and it's time for me to take a drink. Now, I suspect that most people here recognize that this is a small piece of the Iguazu Falls, a wonderful place, and I look forward to being back there. This was after a week of violent thunderstorms every night, so the water was very brownish, and there was a lot of water. Okay, but what I'm supposed to be telling you is that the process of advancing science often leads to inventions and technologies that directly benefit mankind. However, it is impossible to know from where a particular advance might come that could solve a problem, a specific problem facing mankind. And I give as just one example, nuclear magnetic resonance as a technology which impacted mankind. Now, nuclear magnetic resonance is something that I use in my work all the time, and I owe that technology to Felix Bloch, who was a professor at Stanford but died before I came there, and Ed Purcell. Now, I should say that Felix Bloch was did not suffer fools lightly. He was a crusty old character. Whereas Ed Purcell, I knew him, and he was a wonderful, kind, gracious person. Well, when these guys won the Nobel Prize just 6 years after their invention of NMR, the press would, of course, deluge them with questions. And I think when Bloch and Purcell tried to answer them using physics, of course, that was hopeless. So eventually, the press tried a different tack. They asked the two of them what they felt that NMR might be good for. And Felix Bloch, who thought that NMR had been invented in order to understand the distribution of charge in atomic nuclei, said, "Damn little." And Ed Purcell, who was a kinder, gentler soul, when asked the same question, said, "Well, maybe one can use nuclear magnetic resonance to calibrate magnetic fields." So these are the visionaries who invented NMR. Let's see what NMR has actually been used for. Well, eventually people were able to create very homogeneous magnetic fields. And when they used NMR on organic solvents, I'm not sure if this is in an organic solvent. Anyway, what they found was that that the protons in hydrogen nuclei didn't all resonate at the same frequency. There were triplets and quadruplets, and these things were typically shifted away from the frequency that you'd see in hydrogen gas at room temperature by a few parts per million. And very quickly, people began to realize that had something to do with the molecular bonding. And so, in fact, at that point, these chemical and spin shifts became, for the first time, measurable, and NMR really became a favored tool by organic chemists all over the world. And I dare say, if you go to an organic chemistry laboratory today, you probably still see an NMR spectrometer. Okay, so the next advance was actually made by a Swedish, bite my tongue, a Swiss scientist, Richard Ernst, right here. Richard Ernst was actually working for Varian Associates in Palo Alto, which is, of course, very close to Stanford University. And he realized that there was a better way of doing NMR. Before that, you'd basically have your sample contained within a coil, which was the inductor of a tuned circuit. And then as you swept the frequency and you went through resonance, there would be a drop in the Q of that circuit, the electrical Q. And Richard Ernst suggested that one could use very powerful, very short pulses of RF that would allow you, if they were at the right frequency, to tip the spins, so all of the spins in the sample simultaneously, and that they would then process in the plane perpendicular to the applied magnetic field. And in fact, that then allowed one to do all sorts of different kinds of nuclear magnetic resonance, which allowed one to determine molecular bond lengths really quite easily. Now, it's kind of interesting. Richard Ernst got the Nobel Prize fairly quickly. Here he is in 1991, and of course, Nobel laureates are always smiling. No, when they get the prize. So this is Richard Ernst. The first Nobel Prize for NMR was in physics, but in fact, this was a very important contribution to chemistry. So in fact, Richard Ernst, even though he was probably a physicist, he got the Nobel Prize for his contributions to chemistry. But Richard Ernst actually was working with someone else during this entire period of time who did not share the Nobel Prize with him. And in fact, since Richard Ernst got the prize by himself, there's no excuse for his colleague not getting the prize. And that person was Kurt Wüthrich. And I would go to these NMR meetings because I do nuclear magnetic resonance. And I ran into Kurt Wüthrich and I asked him, I said, you know, how did you feel when Richard Ernst got the Nobel Prize and you didn't share it with him? You must have been disappointed. He said, no, I wasn't disappointed. I was mad. And so Richard Ernst then, Kurt Wüthrich actually, almost as a man possessed, proceeded to develop pulse sequences which allowed him to determine not just bond lengths, but the entire conformation of even relatively complicated simple proteins. You can do this, of course. You have to crystallize the material you're looking at and then do X-ray crystallography on it. And there's a question as to whether if you take some very complicated molecule and crystallize it, whether you've changed the conformation of that molecule or not. But here's finally Kurt Wüthrich. Now let's go back in time. I think Richard Ernst got the prize in 1991 and Kurt Wüthrich got the prize in 2002. So it was several years later, but in fact he got his own prize. This one was also in chemistry. There is no prize in biology and it really wasn't medicine yet. So, but coming up to medicine, in fact, we're not done. So far we've seen, I think, four Nobel Prizes for nuclear magnetic resonance. And the fifth one is sort of actually is kind of interesting. I was one of, in a sort of invented a form of magnetic resonance imaging, but in I was only doing it in one dimension. So I was trying to separate the NMR signal from solid helium-3 from the NMR signal from liquid helium-3, which is actually in the superfluid phase. And so I realized that if I applied a magnetic field across my sample and I swept the frequency, I would be going from, let's say, you know, one part of the cell to the other part of the cell would suddenly be in resonance. And I could find regions where there was no solid. A solid had a much larger NMR signal than the liquid. But in fact, it was really some much more serious people that had used pulsed NMR techniques, which I couldn't possibly have done, that realized that you could use NMR to actually determine the structure of biological samples. This is, of course, a very healthy human knee. I know the difference. Well, one of my knees is titanium, and I think you can't do NMR on that one. So for their contributions to NMR in 2003, this is just 1 year after Kurt Wuttrich got the Nobel Prize for NMR in chemistry, Paul Lauterbur and Peter Mansfield shared the Nobel Prize for physiology and medicine 1 year later. So, I mean, this is absolutely remarkable that the people that invented NMR could not foresee what it was likely to be useful for. And I don't know if this is maybe a stretch, but in fact, NMR, since that time, another form of NMR has been developed called functional magnetic resonance imaging, where you image the human brain with a pulse sequence which is very sensitive to the rate that the nuclei return parallel to the magnetic field. And then you can actually see those places in the brain that are processing information. Of course, you don't know what the person is thinking, but that's okay. Okay, so now I'm going to talk. I've talked now about a bunch of discoveries, which I know something about, but in fact, I certainly wasn't involved in those discoveries. So I now would like to tell my story of discovery after I get another sip of water. It's sort of interesting coming to some place far away like Colombia. You end up spending all of your time talking with people, and my voice goes out. Okay. So I think I should say I will begin my life with the beginning of my life. No. I think I'm borrowing that from someone else. Anyway, this is a picture of my family. My father was a medical doctor. My mother had been a nurse but gave up nursing in order to raise an unruly brood of brats. No, we were not all brats. Kind of, sort of, once in a while. This is my older brother who actually went into medicine, and I think he's in the process of retiring now, and he was 2 years older than son number two, that's me there, and we actually shared a bedroom together. When he started dating and he would come home late, I would booby trap the room, so as soon as he turned the door, a box of pennies fell on the floor, waking my parents up, and then they of course knew that he had gotten back after curfew time. I was not a nice kid back in those days. Anyway, and so there were five of us. I broke my sister's clavicle. We would play football. Tackled her a little bit too hard. Anyway, enough of that. So I would say the person that probably influenced me the most, my father actually got me interested in science at a very early age. He would give me things that his patients had given him to give to me. I guess he talked about how I was interested in electricity and magnetism and things like that. But the person that really got me thinking about how to do science was William Hawk, my chemistry teacher. Sadly, he died. He actually was alive when I got the Nobel Prize, and so I called him up. and I said, "Mr. Hawk, guess who?" And he said, "Well, that has to be Douglas Osheroff." Now, I think he'd heard that I'd gotten the prize and wondered if I would call him up. But anyway, he came into class one day, and he had a quart milk carton. I guess here it would be a liter milk carton. And inside, there was something there. And he said that research is like trying to find out what's inside the milk carton. You can rotate milk carton about its long horizontal axis, and if what's inside rushes from corner to corner, you know that it has cylindrical symmetry. And so we tried that, and it didn't have cylindrical symmetry. And then he said, you can shake it in larger and larger amplitudes until you hear it hitting the ends of the milk carton. And then it gives you some idea as how long this thing is. And eventually someone guessed that it was a clothespin. But I suppose that most of this audience has no idea what a clothespin was used for. It was actually for hanging clothes on a line so they would dry. Anyway, the way he described research, though, is the way I still think about it to this day. I mean, it is a matter of doing a series of experiments, and the way I like to think of it, tricking nature into giving up one of her secrets. And that's what research is all about, and it's kind of a fun game you play with nature. So, I went to Caltech as an undergraduate, and that was when Richard Feynman was teaching his famous two-year sequence on physics, Feynman lectures on physics, and for me, this was more or less seventh heaven. I mean, you know, getting physics from someone who was so accomplished and so brilliant, but of course, Feynman also required a lot of his students. So, my freshman class, entering class, was 192, and only 120 returned for their sophomore year. And I think Feynman had a lot to do with that, actually. But he was certainly, for most Caltech students, even the ones that couldn't probably get better than a C. And of course, he was God. And you know, we all loved Richard Feynman. And I remember when he got the Nobel Prize, some students hung a big sign up on the top of the administration building, which of course they weren't chastised for having done. And in fact, Feynman, when he died, his daughter took all of his correspondence and wrote a book, created a book of his letters, essentially. And in that letter was a letter from Richard Feynman to the Caltech undergraduates, thanking them for their sign of congratulations to him when he got the Nobel Prize. So after, you know, it was a heady time at Caltech, and I was actually working in an infrared astrophysics program. And I would go up to Mount Wilson Observatory and run this telescope, and I was up there when two other students discovered the center of the Milky Way galaxy in the infrared. And so it was a really heady time, and that next fall it was time to apply for graduate programs, and I applied to 8 schools that had very good astrophysics programs. And then, you know, I actually got into all of the schools, and then it was time to make the decisions. And I started thinking about, you know, myself, who I am and what I really enjoy doing and what motivated me. And I realized that what I really loved doing was doing experiments, asking questions of nature, tricking nature into giving up her secrets. And you can't do experiments in astrophysics. You can't change the temperature of a star and see what happens. So at the last moment, I actually decided that I would go into condensed matter physics, because there, in fact, the experiments were relatively short, and you could maybe do 2 or 3 in a year or something like that. But there was no one at Caltech, no faculty member in condensed matter physics. So that spring, Mossbauer, who had some loose connections at Caltech, would always come in the spring. I don't know why, but it's nice in Europe at that time of year, and give a series of lectures. And so after one of his lectures, I went up to Mossbauer and explained to him my quandary and asked what school he would recommend that I go to for graduate study. And he looked at the list and said, well, there are only two good schools in the United States in condensed matter physics, and you didn't apply to either one. And they were, in fact, University of Illinois, which had just a few years before developed the theory that explained superconductivity, and University of California, which is certainly a very good school. So I looked at the schools that I had applied to, and of course, neither one of those schools were in that list. And so I said, well, of the schools I did apply to, what would you recommend? He said, either Cornell or the University of Washington. Well, since I'm from Washington State, I didn't want to go home. And so I decided to go to Cornell, not realizing that it was, in fact, a remarkable time to go to Cornell. At the low temperature group at Cornell gave two seminars that first semester, one on both on new refrigeration technologies. One was on the helium-3, helium-4 dilution refrigerator, and that year I actually built my own dilution refrigerator, which reached temperatures of about 15 thousandths of a degree above absolute zero. And the other was a very unlikely proposal by a Russian plasma physicist named Isaac Pomeranchuk, who when people started talking about properties of helium-3, he proposed a refrigeration process where you take liquid helium-3 at low temperatures and compress it to the point where part of the liquid sample is converted to solid. And for every, well, the actual numbers are, for every percent of the liquid that you convert to solid, the system would cool by 1/1000th of a degree. So if you could start at 15 millidegrees, you could essentially reach absolute zero by only converting 15% of the liquid into solid. And so I said, I have to have one of these things. I'm not making it. So I joined the low temperature group. I think I'm way behind somehow. No, here we go. There. This is far above Cayuga's waters with its wave. I can't believe I'm singing the Cornell alma mater here in Columbia. Anyway, this is Cornell in the fall. Now, it's sort of interesting. When I first showed up at Cornell, it was, I guess, late August, because I had to find housing off campus. And I went into the cafeteria, one of the dormitory cafeterias, and there was this cute little Chinese girl sitting all by herself eating. And this is, of course, my wife, who this is in fact was in her passport when she came to the United States from Taiwan. So we've been married now for 42 years, and I think we've had a very good marriage, and we love each other, and we've had a good time together. So all I can say is when you get to the school for graduate study, for you undergraduate students, look around in the cafeteria. So I got busy working then. And of course, this is in fact a seminar, I can't remember which one, on dilution refrigerators. This is pure helium-3 in the top, and a mixture of superfluid helium-4 with about 6% helium-3 below that. And if you connect this to a still at a temperature of about, roughly a half a degree, what you pump off is mostly helium-3, and that then causes this helium-4 superfluid to be depleted of helium-3. More helium-3 would diffuse across this phase boundary, and in the process it would cool. And so I got very busy, and I think by the end of my first year of graduate study, I had made helium-3, helium-4 dilution refrigerator. Now, I have to confess, it didn't work yet. It wasn't until the second year of graduate study that it worked, but I loved working with my hands, and I loved building things. So the Pomeranchuk, I told you that Pomeranchuk had this proposal, and what he realized was that you have a very unusual situation at low temperatures in helium-3. Normally, liquid helium-3 is a degenerate Fermi fluid, so its entropy drops linearly with temperature. This is absolute zero. Whereas in the solid, although you have very high degree of positional ordering, each atom has a nuclear spin, and until you get to very low temperatures, those spins can either point up or down. And that gives you an entropy of R log 2 per mole, and that's this line here. So you have the very unusual situation below about 3/10 of a degree that the liquid is more highly ordered than the solid. But what Pomeranchuk realized was that as you converted liquid into solid, in fact, the system would cool, and that was the proposal. Basically, you start with all liquid. This is the melting line. And as you reached this and converted liquid to solid, you would go to lower and lower temperatures, and ultimately, you could reach temperatures of about 1/10,000th of a Kelvin. So this is, in fact, now I should tell you that this is my Pomeranchuk cell. The design of this was finalized while I lay in the hospital bed recovering from knee surgery. So I suppose having a titanium knee is a good thing, or at least it was for me. So at the end of my third year of graduate study, Liu Xijiang, Xiao Dai is her diminutive name, was going to go back to Taiwan. We'd been dating for quite a while, and I realized that if I wanted to marry this girl, I better do it quickly. So here we are. This is August 14th, 1970. And we got married in a beautiful formal garden very close to the physics building. I didn't take out time to take data points, but in fact, of course, my thesis advisor was there. So we went on our honeymoon, and this is my favorite early picture of my wife, actually, in Grand Teton National Park. If any of you are coming, it's a really remarkably beautiful place. And anyway, we had a wonderful time, and we've been back there several times. So, okay, I got back to Cornell. And of course, it was the end of my third year of graduate study, or the beginning of my fourth year, and I figured I had just 2 years to do something that would get me a job in physics. And so Dave Lee had gotten a paper from another researcher in California, actually, and he had looked at what should happen to the melting pressure of liquid solid helium-3 as a function of magnetic field and temperature. And the theory suggested, in fact, there should only be a small suppression in the melting pressure. But in fact, when I did the experiment, he did the experiment, he found a much larger effect. So that looked very exciting, and Dave Lee said, well, I should go in there and do that experiment. So my data are these red triangles, and in fact, they're entirely consistent with this curve, but in fact, there was scatter in my data. Now, I needed to use an NMR spectrometer to take this data, and there was only one NMR quality iron core electromagnet in the lab, and two other students had been waiting for a long time for me to give this to them. So eventually, they went up to the two professors and argued that I should have to give up this magnet, which meant I couldn't continue doing this experiment. And so I gave it away, and it was only then that I actually did something that would ever have given me a job in physics. And so first thing I did is I wanted to test this conjecture by Pomeranchuk. So I was slowly converting the liquid to solid, and the system was cooling. This is melting pressure, actually. Pressure is increasing upward, and time is to the right. And here I rebalance the capacitance bridge, which measures pressure, and it continues to cool. But then at this point that I later labeled as A, there was a very sharp decrease in the rate of cooling. Of course, I was very distraught and unhappy with this. But in the end, this turned out to be the signature of superfluidity in helium-3. So eventually I found that there was not only this transition, which originally we called this the glitch, but afterward we had to give it a formal name, so we called it the A transition. There was in fact another transition called the B transition, and these, in the end, we realized these were both in the liquid phase, not in the solid phase, and you could see them on cooling and also on warming. So in order to find out whether it was the liquid or solid that was doing this, I actually created an early form of MRI. Here's the magnetic field with the field gradient, and this is the resonant layer. And if I swept the frequency upward, this layer would move down. And so I could easily separate out those parts which were NMR signal, which were due to liquid helium-3, and those that were due to solid. And so this is real data now. Time is increasing to the left for some reason, because I actually turned this whole thing upside down. People don't want to think of these resonance peaks as absorption peaks. So the bottom line is here I'm going from low frequency to high frequency, and there's all sorts of solid in here. I see these peaks and stuff like that. There's this little region here where I could see actually just liquid helium-3. But at very low temperatures, this is very close to 2.5 millidegrees, the liquid signal seemed to be very badly distorted. This is time increasing to the left, so I'm going from here to here and then back the other direction. And as I watched this, in fact, all of a sudden I saw this drop in pressure at this B transition, and then when I looked at what happened to the liquid NMR line, it dropped by about a factor of two. So I wrote that in my lab book. This was April 20th, 1972, 2:40 in the morning. What a great time to be doing research. No one bothers you at 2:40 in the morning. Have discovered the BCS transition in liquid helium-3 tonight. And then, you know, I realized that this is something that people had been looking for decades, and here it was in my cryostat. So I ran around the basement of the physics building to share this exciting news with some of the graduate students. It turns out no one was there. In desperation, I went up to the sixth floor. Now, you understand that theory students always like to be up high because they think they talk directly to God. But it turns out there were no theory students had fallen asleep at their desks. So at 4 in the morning, I couldn't stand it any longer. I called up my thesis advisor. Now, I don't recommend you do that unless you're really sure that you're right. Anyway, so Dave Lee then called me back at 6 in the morning, and he wanted more details, and I was still there. But in fact, it was certainly the most exciting evening of my life. So eventually I started looking at, we'd been mainly looking at that B transition, which was very clear, easy to see. And Bob Richardson, or Dave Lee, I can't remember which one, had suggested maybe I should look at the A transition. So I had I finally got the magnet back. So this was the all liquid NMR signal, just a little tiny thing. Solid has a much larger NMR signal. And this is mainly due to solid at a temperature which was just barely above the temperature where we saw this A transition to occur. And what we found was, I was completely awestruck. The liquid NMR signal moved out from underneath the solid NMR signal, and as I cooled, it went to higher and higher frequencies until we saw the drop at this B transition, as I called it. And then the signal disappeared as it went back underneath the solid peak. And I was bewildered. Ultimately, we found that if we looked at the liquid frequency squared minus the solid NMR frequency, or the Larmor frequency squared, we found that those data were, if we plotted liquid frequency squared minus solid frequency squared, the difference was in fact independent of the strength of the applied magnetic field, which seemed very strange. And I sent this paper off, a preprint. It did, by the way, got rejected by Physical Review Letters the first time around, to a young researcher at in Sussex University in England named Tony Leggett. And Tony Leggett came up with the entire theory that explains superfluidity and the spin dynamics of helium-3. And so, in fact, this line is what Tony explained. So let me not go on, but obviously that was in 1972, and in 1996 I got the Nobel Prize. But I dare say, I think for me, the excitement was really not the Nobel Prize, but understanding something about nature. So let me just give research strategies, utilize new technologies, as I said before, to view nature from a new perspective or in a different realm. Don't give up when things are going badly, like when other graduate students steal a key piece of your equipment. Failure may be an invitation to try something new, and it was only then that I made the discovery. Spend a little time doing something different. Curiosity-driven research is fun and can be rewarding. And I think this is one that's very important. Avoid too many commitments. The demands of good research do not adhere to a schedule. And I say, you know, I can't remember what it was, but there was something I was supposed to be doing during this period of time, but in fact, I avoided it. I stayed in the laboratory. And finally, back off from what you're doing occasionally to gain a better perspective on the task at hand. We become myopic when we focus too tightly on our work. I think that's really good advice, particularly for young researchers. So after all that, here Dave Lee, my thesis advisor, Bob Richardson, who's the professor that really trained me in low temperature techniques, and yours truly, exhibiting our new Nobel medals. And although I felt bad that Tony Leggett was in fact one of my guests at the Nobel festivities, but in fact I felt that Tony should get his own Nobel Prize, which he did in 2003, not too many years later. So. Which he shared with two Russian physicists, Abrakosov and Ginzburg. And here's Tony getting his Nobel Prize. And of course, I was one of Tony's guests at the Nobel festivities, as Tony had been our guest. So last thing I want to do is show this. This is my Pomeranchuk cell again. And now I've decorated this schematic diagram with the names of people who contributed understanding or technologies that were essential for my making this discovery. Edwards and Hall, who invented the helium-3, helium-4 dilution refrigerator. Bloch and Purcell for inventing NMR, which was a key for me in understanding. Bardeen, Cooper, and Schrieffer for their theory of superconductivity, which was rather easily, at least for Phil Anderson, applicable to superfluid helium-3. Pomeranchuk for his suggestion for this refrigeration technology. Ed Hamill was the person that actually, I call him the father of helium-3 physics. He was the person that separated the helium-3 out from the nation's tritium supply and measured properties of helium-3 in the liquid state. And then Wheatley did most of the development work on the dilution refrigerator. Lev Landau for his work of Fermi liquid theory. Strachey and Adams actually designed this remarkable pressure transducer that would measure pressures with a resolution of a part in 10 to the ninth while dumping no more than 1 nanowatt of energy into my apparatus. So I would end by saying that advances in science are seldom made by individuals alone. They result from the progress of the scientific community, asking questions, demanding new, developing new technologies to answer those questions, and sharing their results and their ideas with others. To have rapid progress, one must support scientific research broadly and encourage scientists to interact with one another and to spend a bit of their time satisfying their own curiosities. This is how advances in science are made. Thank you. Then we broke for dinner at 6 p.m., eat on campus, go back to work. And so usually at midnight, I would drive my wife home. And then I would go, then she put her hair up in pin curlers back in those days. And it took a long time for the hair to dry. And so I would go back and usually work until 4 in the morning. And so it worked out very well. And maybe the hours got changed slightly as we got older, but in fact, I think we were able to accommodate the two career characteristic of our marriage quite well. I should say that we've never had any children. When asked that question by undergraduates, I always tell them, I think of them as my children. Any other questions? One way in the back. Okay, there's someone.
On an average day, how much time will you dedicate to your investigation?
Well, look, I hate to say it, but I'm essentially retired now, so I'm dedicating a lot of time to, I hope, communicating the excitement of science to people all over the world and maybe giving some good advice about how to be a good scientist. In terms of when I was working at Bell Laboratories, well, those were the hours. They were long hours. I like to think I like to work hard and play hard, too. So, you know, when we take breaks, we would go places like Grand Canyon or our honeymoon was in Grand Teton National Park. So we love the outdoors and we love photography. And so we do that pretty passionately, too. Any other questions? So there's this one way in the back.
Okay. My question is, what is a superfluid useful for?
What is a superfluid in helium-3 useful for? Well, it is a neutral analog to superconductivity, but it was actually the first case where the Cooper pairs that are formed in this BCS superfluid state, in the case of helium-3, it's a superfluid, not a superconductor, that has internal degrees of freedom. It has both orbital angular momentum and spin angular momentum. And that really makes it remarkably easier to probe the system. So I think it has been kind of, it was probably the first unconventional BCS state. BCS is the theory that explains superconductivity. But in fact, in this particular case, there were just so many different, easier ways to probe it than one could ever have done before. So I think it was probably really a wonderful way for physicists to learn about this kind of order. Because the temperatures are so low, that is to say, within 2/1000ths of a degree of absolute zero, there are no commercial applications. It's just costs too much money to get to these low temperatures. I'm doing this. This thing has died on me. There was someone that had thought they could make a gyroscope using superfluid helium-3. But then, in fact, after actually making this thing, he realized, in fact, one could use superfluid helium-4 just as well, and it would be a lot cheaper, and you only had to get down to 4 degrees above absolute zero. Any more questions? Well, there's one over there. I think, I'm sorry. Let's do the second level. I completely ignored you people up there.
Yeah. As with the people who discovered NMR, what did you think your discovery would be useful for at the moment you discovered it, and what do you think it will be useful in the future?
Okay, well, as I said, because the temperatures required for superfluid helium-3 are so low, I think it doesn't have any applications in the conventional sense. However, it was, in fact, I would say, a classroom for physicists to learn what kinds of order are possible in nature and what their properties are. And I think that was actually a very valuable lesson for us all to learn. Okay, no one's up. Someone has to have a microphone up there for me to get your questions upstairs. No one has, there's no microphones upstairs? Okay, go for it. Ask your question.
Yeah.
Oh, not so loud.
sorry. I'm kind. I wanted to ask you how hard it was for you to like study science, because sometimes it overwhelms you and it's kind of difficult. And what were your most important difficulties in the undergraduate studies, and how did you do in that beginning to make science?
Okay, well, I must say that I was, as you are aware, one of Richard Feynman's students, but everyone in my freshman class was a Richard Feynman student, so that didn't say very much. I became fascinated by electricity and magnetism when I was 6 years old. And so I think, I was absolutely in love with physics by the time I went off to Caltech to be an undergraduate there. And I don't think I ever thought about being anything other than a physicist. So there was a brief period when I thought about going in astrophysics, but in fact, as I said, astrophysicists can't do experiments, and I love doing experiments. I guess the one thing that I'm fortunate is that I managed to survive my childhood. I won't tell you how many times near-death experiences occurred due to experiments. Okay, so there's someone up on the second level.
As you called your teacher to tell him about your prize, have you ever been called by someone that has been your student or has attended a lecture like this?
To inform me that one of my students had won the Nobel Prize, I dearly wish that would happen in some case, but I think the statistics on that are not very good.
Well, no, I'm not talking about the Nobel Prize. Any remarkable breakthrough?
I didn't hear the first part of that. What?
That I'm not talking about specifically winning the Nobel Prize, but.
Well, I have to say there are several times in my career that I've discovered something that I think is interesting. I don't think any of these things are actually have any commercial value, but in fact end up demonstrating new physics that people hadn't predicted before. I love to think of myself as tricking nature into giving up her secrets. And that's for me, that's something I was willing to do for most of my career. Anyone else? Okay, here's one down here, and there's one back there.
I'd like to know, where do you think are the, the unexplored regions of physics where we can, make new discoveries?
Well, it's hard to know what's not been discovered until you discover it. So, I think you have to look at, certainly if you're looking at a new system, that people haven't studied very much, I think you, or certainly if it's really worthwhile to read PhysRev letters and things like that, because here you can see what scientists all over the world, physicists, are thinking about, and you can get very quickly evidence of their results of some new behavior which had not been predicted. So I think those are certainly two things. Now, that said, I I should tell you I'm a slow reader, and so I don't read everything I should. but in fact, and going to also international meetings are a really, really good way of meeting people and talking. I mean, you can learn far more on a one-on-one basis talking about science than by sitting in and listening to other people telling you about the science that they've done, because you can ask questions and it's a two-way dialogue then. Thank you, that's a good question. There's someone right here, yes.
I want to ask you if you have some proposals for us to take as a future experiment that we can make that you think that might be useful for us.
Well, I think you have to. I started doing experiments at Cornell when I was a first year graduate student, and so it wasn't that I instantly made the discovery or anything like that. But I think it really helps to look at what new areas of science. I mean, like when graphene came out, I think it's still true that there are just enormous number of people that are studying variations on graphene. And that'll go on for a while, and then after a while, one won't be learning very much about that system. I mean, I think graphene is one of these things that potentially, I mean, it looks like it has maybe commercial potential in it. But I think the first thing you have to do is decide what kind of activities you enjoy doing the most, and then try to choose a career, and not necessarily science, that allows you to spend a large fraction of your time doing things that you really enjoy doing. And if you do that, it doesn't matter what field you go into, as long as it's something that you're good at and you enjoy doing, you will be productive and you will be rewarded for the progress that you make. Thank you, that's a very good question. Okay, way over there.
I think you have already said, but I want to know what is the formula of success of life?
Oh, geez, I don't think there is one. I guess what I should say, that's biology. I'm a physicist. I'm sorry. Okay, here we go. Two more, okay. So we're only two more questions, and you guys, if there are more people, you could duke it out up here on stage. No. Okay, who would like to be next? Okay, this one. Now keep in mind, one of the last two, so don't make it a meaningless question. I don't want to put pressure on you, but
well, it's like, based on the difficulties you faced during like your career and else, what will be like advice for the people that would like to develop on the research field?
I couldn't, could someone? Okay, how to become a research scientist. First of all, it helps to start when you're very young, but not necessary, obviously. I was very good with my hands by the time, I was an undergraduate student already. That was one thing. Obviously, you have to know a body of knowledge. I mean, you're very unlikely to discover something new if you don't understand what's already been discovered. So that's another thing. But then, I think when you're doing probing a system that potentially looks interesting, how you probe it. I think there is a real talent in learning how to probe a system. I mean, what for instance, you want to use NMR, you want to use ESR, electron spin resonance, or various different ways of doing things. And I think a good experimental physicist will acquire a broad knowledge of what kinds of tools he or she should be applying in order to understand the system that they've found or that looks quite interesting. Okay, I think we have one more question, is that right? Okay, this is the last question right here in the front. Okay, so I think you're close enough. It's a bad question, I'll throw something at you.
After your discovery in your field, which other major discoveries have you witnessed in the field of superconductivity and superfluidity? And which other developments would you expect or would you like to see in the future, like demonstrations or discoveries in your field?
Yeah, I think helium-3 is sadly a very well understood system right now. Part of it's because of work that I've done, and part of it's because of work that other people have done. But I think there are lots of systems that are not very well understood. And, of course, the best thing is to discover a new system and then try to understand it. I mean, that's always works. But if it's something like understanding the properties of, let's say, graphene with an overlayer of helium-3 atoms or something like that at low temperatures, I mean, certainly those are experiments that you could do. And I think this, again, the way I like to think about doing research is that every time you do an experiment, you're asking a question of nature. And so it's simply a matter of every time you ask, do an experiment, you're really looking at the same problem from a different perspective. And that's really how you learn more about what it is that you've been looking at.
Or specifically, you don't foresee or forecast some particular developments or discoveries, let's say, in terms of other elements or other isotopes, I guess, in a similar way, like your discovery of superfluidity.
Well, no. I dare say, I think that a lot of those discoveries, I don't know, the idea, graphene is a good example, okay. I mean, obviously, the fact that you can create graphene using scotch tape suggests that it shouldn't be all that hard to study, and yet it sat there for a long time. So, I mean, I think a good experimental scientist is usually a clever person who comes up with novel ways of doing things. And, that allows you to both look at a specific problem and understand it more easily. But like with NMR, I mean, NMR was invented in order to solve a specific problem, but in fact, it had legs that went throughout not just the physics community, the chemistry, and even physiology or medicine. So I think you are challenged by nature in order to understand something, and then you have to come up with some ways of reaching that understanding. That sounds like a very simplistic way of doing it, but in fact, I think that advice that I've just given you is good advice for almost anyone that's working in experimental science. Fair enough? Nope. Okay, well, I think we have to end this now, I guess. I want to thank you all for coming, and I appreciate your questions, and I wish you all the very best in your careers, whether it be physics or chemistry or corporate law.